Again.
Okay.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Force Realists TV. I am your host, Alethea Thompson, and on the line, I have Luciana Morningstar. I have a woman. I have a woman on my show.
Absolutely. About time.
Yes.
About time. Been a bit of a sausage party so far.
Yes, and you're a real woman, you know, because I'm over here, I'm wearing this hoodie, and you've got this nice outfit on. I feel underdressed. I don't care though.
You're a bit of the you're a guy's gal, you know. You seem to like hanging out with the boys a bit more. I'm very girly. I got pink in my room back here.
Oh man, and a full music setup and a telescope. I don't know how much people can see in this, but she's got a telescope in the background and a harp and a piano. And I found out earlier she's got a blue. I know the word. Guitar over there next to her.
Such a hard word.
Well, I'm really weird. You're like, of course you are. You're a Jedi and you don't even like Star Wars. So yeah.
Even if you weren't a Jedi, I think I would still put you in that category.
Yeah.
But that's just me. I say that with love.
Well, I love you too.
It's all right. I got my Slytherin house robes hanging up in the back.
Oh,
so
no,
I'm
that's
also
awesome.
Pretty weird. My Death Eater wand over there.
Luciana is a Lady of the Sith, and she's over at Force Academy and Order of the Sith. She has been with us for years, and she is one of the most awesome women I've had the privilege of meeting in person.
Thank you. It's also been quite a privilege to know you, Ali. You're a lovely person.
Even though I'm too bubbly sometimes.
You're not too bubbly. You're lovely. Don't listen to the haters, okay? Listen to Taylor Swift. Haters don't hate.
Shake it off. Shake it off.
There you go. You're getting girlier by the second.
Yes, yes, yes. So we were actually both talking about how even though we're on opposite ends of the country, we have the same weather.
Yes, it is. Well, it has been pouring with rain here. It stopped for a brief hour or so, which is good. We had the power go out a couple of nights ago.
Oh, no.
You don't really expect that in California.
Wow. Yeah, that is kind of, wow. Somebody run into the transformer?
No, just the winds were that bad.
Oh, my goodness.
Power lines swaying, although we did have some schools get damaged quite severely. So,
I thought that was just confined over to South Georgia and Mississippi.
Oh my gosh, it's nothing as bad as what's happening in Georgia, I'm sure, and Mississippi. It's bad for us.
Right.
We're like the spoiled people of the United States. What do you mean it's not sunny out there? How am I going to get my tan now?
So why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
All right. Well, you've already done a lot of the legwork. I am from Order of the Sith. I started there in 2011, and I have been a member of the Force communities since about 2005, though. So I feel old, Ali.
If it makes you feel any better, I've been in the community since 2002.
I know. I just can't even believe it sometimes that, you know, we started off so young, so fresh-faced and so idealistic, and now we're here and we're all terribly jaded and like, oh, Star Wars. Who gives a crap about that?
Disney is killing it. I'm the only one over here like, I think they're actually doing a really good job. Blasphemy.
I won't get into that. It's different. It's different. But I don't think different is always bad. That's possibly why I'm on the dark side. So, So yes, Force Academy. I am a Dark Knight at the Force Academy. And I am a Sith Lady at the Order of the Sith, and we are in the process of revamping Order of the Sith. It's quite exciting. We just bought our own domain, orderofthesith.org. Go check it out. It looks beautiful. Chaos will hopefully be posting his podcasts there. Miles and I are hopefully going to get some conversations going up there. And then there's all the old stuff that you're all bored of reading by now. So that's still there too.
Hey, sometimes you can go in and at least learn about the people. Like, I like seeing the transformation that has happened with certain members of the community that you look at them and you're just like, oh, that person used to be like this. I think it's tragic that Force Academy's old boards, when we were .com, kind of went down and all of our archives went to hell because I lost my entire holocrone.
Train yourself to let go of everything you fear to lose.
Oh, are you really going to throw that one off me?
I am.
I don't fear to lose it. I just dislike losing it.
I can quote scripture. I mean, Yoda.
I don't like Yoda. Yoda's a Sith. He's one of yours.
Oh, okay.
You're like, I'll take him.
Well, we're not as exclusionary as you are, Allie.
I would like to think I'm... No, actually, I'm really not. But even Chaos thinks that we need to be more exclusive than even what I have. So...
Yeah, well, I would agree. But I have been very vocal about that in other places. Yeah. So.
So we're going to talk about Maslow's hierarchy today, which is something that we wanted to talk about a long time ago when we first met up in person. We had, what was it, a 3-hour conversation in a Mediterranean restaurant?
It was a curry place. It was Indian. Yes, oh my
that's
goodness.
Right.
You and your ethnicity. You can't sing in Spanish. You don't know what curry comes from.
No, I just couldn't remember. Like, in Japan, I had curry, too. So curry can be Japanese if you have your own Japanese spin.
It's
a very different curry.
So, yeah, we met in a curry joint in Berkeley when I was still at school there. And, we were going to talk about this, but I think I had class and you had life to get back to.
I had a boat to get back to. Trust me, I would have much preferred being with you.
Thank you. But yeah, and then I remember you messaged me on Facebook saying, please write up this thing. And I was like, all right, I'm going to do it this weekend. And 2 years later.
We're doing a podcast instead.
We're doing a podcast instead. You pinned me down. Congratulations.
Well, I'm just glad that I got you on the show. I mean, I've been wanting to get you on the show for a while, but I wasn't sure how you felt about getting on video.
Oh, it's true. It adds like 10 pounds. So I'm very self-conscious right now.
You're much better dressed than I am. And I'm in this thing that probably adds 30 pounds. And then when you add the camera, 50?
I just wish you would add it to my hair. Can you just like make my hair more floofy? More bouffanty? No. Maslow's hierarchy, Allie, stay on topic.
Okay, yes. I am, what's the word? I'm doing it again. No, were you like, you're talking about something. Oh, shiny!
You're easily distracted?
Yes, that's what I'm looking for. So I was actually going to explain this to you because I didn't get around to it before my son came in and interrupted us. There was a time when I was in Japan, and we were getting ready to come back to the States so that I could have our actual wedding ceremony. So I'm sitting there, and I couldn't think, literally could not think of two words. I said, and it was, let me see if I can't even help you, see if you can figure out exactly what I was talking about. I was like, we have to go to the place tomorrow. And we need a ride, but we have to go to the place where this thing, it comes in and it lands, and then it goes up into the air, and it's a place where it lands, but we need to get into the thing that does this. And they were like,
the airport? Get on a...
Yeah. I was like, I can't, I couldn't, they were like, you can't think of the word airport. I think it happened when I was dropped out of a second story window at 18 months old. Okay, I didn't actually get dropped, I fell. I was watching a basketball game and I fell, which is probably why I hate all sports now.
Well, one, that sounds like an excuse. And two, if you just fell, why are you saying you dropped? That's like exaggeration where
it was a second story window and I did totally crack my skull, which is the only reason I'm still alive today. So I probably got some decent brain damage.
Your skull cracked.
So that's something that sometimes I'll do. I don't think I've done it on the show yet until today.
I'm special.
But I do it all the time. Like, I'll think of something and I'm like, I won't think of the word phone. I use this word probably more than almost any other word that's not is, the, or whatever. And sometimes I'll be like, the thing that I do this with. People are like, your phone? Yes, that's the word.
Well, things you can't even use like this anymore because phones haven't been this shape in a really long time.
Yeah, right?
Like, I do my thing.
I do remember when I used to hold one like that. So,
that's... Come now, Ali, let's not give away our ages.
Oh, gosh. That's a good point.
You are older than me, so I'm okay. Everyone, Ali is much older than me.
I'm only 31.
Much older.
Okay, so we're going to talk about Maslow's hierarchy.
We are, eventually.
It's nice to have her on the line. It's, you know, I haven't been able to talk with her in vocal for a long time. So, okay. So this Maslow's hierarchy has 5 different stages.
It does.
So what's the point of Maslow's hierarchy?
Oh, interesting question. So, see, I thought you were going to have to just make me explain it. I was like, well, this is going to be kind of boring. But now the point of Maslow's hierarchy is actually the 5th point, which is self-actualization. And the idea is that it's ridiculous to expect people to reach self-actualization, which can be described probably best as the realization of one's full potential, while they're still worrying about the other 4 tiers. So at Order of the Sith, I'm pretty concerned with reaching maximum potential, with helping other people reach maximum potential. And one of the things that I'll do is I'll ask silly questions when they first come in, and they probably think I'm insane and leave. But I'm sort of like testing where they are on the pyramid. So we had someone come in a little while ago, and they were talking about wanting to make change. And well, that's not quite technically true. We found out that they were talking about wanting to make change. Before that, they were talking about how they had all this negative energy and they were afraid of it. And one of the things that is very true for me in Sith philosophy is you take your negative and you turn it into gold. You make it something real, something you can be proud of. You take all that anger and your fury and you conquer the world with it, damn it. Because that's what it's for. I'm all like, so.
Well, that almost sounds like you're saying go and conquest and be Hitler. I know you're not, but.
Aren't I?
You would go that way, wouldn't you?
Hitler achieved many great things in his lifetime. All of his dreams came true, except for the one where he won. So.
Yeah, okay, fair.
Yeah, what have you done that compares to what Hitler managed?
I got nothing.
So this person came in, and through talking to them, I realized that they were actually stuck in the 2nd tier, which is safety and survival. So I'll just do a very quick recap, I suppose. The 1st tier is what you actually need to survive. So that's food, oxygen. You don't really need a roof over your head, just food, oxygen, and water. If you don't have those things, then you can't even think about the next level, which is security. And, you know, you see this with people who live with abusive partners or abusive family members, where because they're getting fed, they're not going to move out. Because these needs are being met, they're happy to stay in an unsafe place. So, When you find people who are kind of stuck in these 2 tiers, and we do have a couple of them come in occasionally at the Order of the Sith, the question really is are you actually free to be a Sith? Are you free to be a Jedi as well? Are you free to make your own decisions if you're still stuck and being, I can't think of the word, still controlled by these particular influences? And then above that, you have family and belonging, and then above that, you have your self-esteem. So for me, it's really quite interesting to sort of poke at people when I first meet them and find out, where are you? Because there's no way you're realizing your maximum potential if you're still stuck worrying about how you're going to eat. And another way that I like to use it personally is every now and then where I'm like feeling pretty good about myself, I'm going to go and look down the pyramid and check what can be improved. So maybe you've got enough food to eat, but are you eating pizza every day? When I was at university, I kind of was eating pizza every day. So how can I fix that? And for me, particularly as well, the relationship tier often needs revisiting because I haven't chosen to make relationships a priority in my path to world conquest. So you look like, oh.
Well, now, and I can understand. I can definitely understand that. And even at that, when you look at the relationships, are your relationships actually healthy? Because a lot of times people will go on Facebook and they think that, okay, if I just get a bunch of likes, and there's been a whole thing about this where I get a bunch of likes on things that it makes you feel like you have these relationships with people, but you don't really.
Absolutely. And that's why you're looking at the third and the fourth tiers. You're looking at the third tier, which is to require a sense of belonging. And if you don't have a sense of belonging in your offline life, you're going to look for it online. And then all of your self-esteem isn't coming from offline achievements. It's coming from likes, how many views my YouTube video gets, how many clicks this gets. And it can become pretty vicious. So you do have to figure out where a person is in terms of who they belong with and where they find their sense of belonging and where they get their self-esteem.
Do you think that might be a problem in our community? Because I know you've been part of the Force Realists community for years now, so you've seen different orders and how they progress. And I know that I've noticed a lot of people who come into the Jedi community and they feel they come in looking for somebody that a group of people that's going to accept them because they don't have it elsewhere. Do you think there's a way to build friendships online?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's not even a question. And I will say it's better than it was. In 2005, when the internet was still kind of new, we had people who were spending their entire lives. I mean, Jedi Masters, I don't know so much about how the Sith communities were back in those days, but the Jedi Masters were spending their entire lives online. And they were Jedi Masters because they never got into fights in forums. And it's sort of, it's changed a lot. And I really do prefer the way it's currently more set up. You know, if people take 6 days to reply to a thread, it's okay. We assume that people have real lives. I mean, that might be part of us all growing up together too. You know, when we were 19, we could sit online all day and just talk.
That's so true.
You're wrong. Someone's wrong on the internet.
I remember seeing a lot of people at Force Academy when I first got there, and they were all in college at the time. And they, to keep their finances down, they just basically worked on the internet.
Well, I gotta say, I don't know how anybody stays active on forums while at university. I do regret that while I was at Berkeley, I let my online friendship slide a bit because I was, you know me, straight A student. couldn't be anything but perfect. So, but I ended up, you know, I only just came back because I only just graduated. And, I had something I was going to say. Oh, yeah. It's sometimes a little hard on me that I'm not able to speak to everyone online as often as I would like to because, you know, you're a great friend. Chaos is a good friend. David, I have so many people online that I really like them. And it takes so long to sit down and sit in a chat room for an hour to have a conversation that you could basically have in 10 minutes if you had it on the phone. So, yeah, you can definitely have real online friendships online. The online Jedi, you know what? No. You guys suck. The online Sith community has helped me through a lot of real life problems. The online
I'll admit it. Yeah, I mean,
he's a whole other beast.
That's very true. Noelle Vok used to be in charge of the dark aspect at one point in time, and something that has always kind of resonated with me when I look at people and I see, especially your transformation when you went to the Sith community, what I noticed, he said, "I am not light because I have." I am dark because I am not yet light. And his belief was that you had to go through this transition where you self-actualized or at least got through most of the tiers to understand what you could do before you could actually go into helping other people.
Well, there's some of that. You've got to put your own oxygen mask on first before you help other people, and you're aware of that. But I think it's also a mistake to view the dark path as only a bridge to becoming a light person.
I agree.
I think the dark path by itself is entirely valid. There are people who are just more drawn to that.
Hold on. Let me... He would call me in the middle of this. And we're back. What were we talking about?
I don't know. Your boyfriend called.
Ah! He's not my boyfriend.
It's all right. I see where I am in your hierarchy of prioritizations.
I love you. I love you. I just thought that, you know, they said that he was at the hospital. And I...
What does your love mean, Allie, when you hang up on me to talk to him?
I didn't hang up on you.
That's true, you didn't. You made me listen to the whole thing.
I wish I could give you a hug.
It's all good. It's fine. It's fine. He's a he. He'll never know what we have.
No, he won't.
I love you too.
I love you.
Okay. We were talking about friendships in the Force community, like ours.
Yes.
Our extraordinary, long, and enduring relationship that relies so much on your patience.
I think that, yeah, and I agree with you. I actually remember we were on the bridge thing, the idea that the dark aspect shouldn't really be a bridge to become light.
I think it can be for some people. I think, you know, you have some people for whom the Jedi are the epitome of inspiration, or the paladins, or the light side people of the world. They are, you know, people who have real light hearts, who have gone through so much stuff in their lives that they're filled with anger and hate. They don't know what to do with it. And they're trying desperately to become good people, but they lash out. And they don't mean to. And so for people like that, I could see how the dark path would be a healing path to bring them to the light. But then there are the people where it's just like, no, we just like it darker.
You have cookies.
No, I don't have cookies. Cookies make you fat. If you come to my house, I will offer you kale and water.
That's the difference between California and the South, the Deep South. I'm not sure upstate South Carolina actually counts as the Deep South, but we'll say it does.
I think if you're in, you say you're in South Carolina?
Yes.
You're automatically in the South. South Carolina.
South, okay, fair. But South Dakota is not automatically South.
South Dakota special. But yes, I did want to say, though, although you can have very meaningful friendships online, I think that there's always a sort of balance that you have to worry about, because you do then come across people for whom their entire identity is online. And you say, well, what do you do in real life? And there's nothing that they do. They have a dead-end 9-to-5 job that they hate, and they have a spouse they ignore, and they have a life out there that they really hate. And they're using this as escapism. Like, I can come online and be the great dark lord of the Sith, and or I can come online and be the great Jedi master. Oh. And here I have authority.
And I'm a Jedi master because I say I am. It's like,
well, no. The more frightening ones are the ones who actually start from the ground up and work their way up and become Jedi masters and Sith lords online. And you never, ever, ever find out that their whole real life is, can I swear? Shit. So you never find out. And before you know it, they're running the shots. They're running the entire show. And it's a very insidious thing. And, you know, there's a great cartoon I remember where there's a dog typing at a keyboard, and it says on the internet, no one knows you're a dog. And it's true. It can be very difficult to actually suss out who's real and who's not, which is, you know, another reason to do things like this. And you can see my piano. Uh-huh. clearly I'm doing something right in the real world.
Yeah, and I actually know exactly, like, I have the exact person in my head right now. And I would not be at all surprised if you and I are thinking the same person.
I think we're thinking about very different people.
Maybe. Maybe.
I'm thinking of several people. I've known several people. Like you said, I've been around a while. I've actually been around, I guess, 12 years. Frick. And I've seen a lot of people where it's just, they work their way. And it surprises you sometimes. It surprises you because you'll think, I've known this person for this many years. And who knew that was happening in real life?
Right. Or the people that actually legitimately got there. I actually have another person in mind that they legitimately got to be master. And then something in their life unhinged.
And oh, I've seen that.
They fall away, and because they are already elevated to that status and nobody notices it because they don't, well, this person, they did notice it because he's actually, he's interacted with people offline in like Jedi gatherings and whatnot. But when other people, they're online and they don't see that happen, then they believe, okay, well, hey, I have this high status. I can't break in front of anybody. And I know I feel that way sometimes. Like if something happens, like when I was in the Coast Guard and I found out that I was getting out. Well, when I got out the day before, I found out that I wasn't getting the money that I needed so that I could make my transition from California all the way over here where I would have my second tier, which is, you know, a place to be able to keep shelter and security and whatnot. We wouldn't be out on the streets. Oh my gosh. I remember that it took everything out of me to go to Force Academy and say, I need prayers right now.
Yeah, it's incredibly difficult. Well, it can be. That's the thing. The online automatically produces this filter. And I'll speak a little bit personally for a second here too. You know, when my father died a couple of years ago, and there was no way I could have gone online and said, oh my God, I'm breaking inside. Because you know, I am Luciana, Sith Lady. Of course my life does what I tell it to do. and so, you know, you actually texted me about a week after it happened saying, do you want to hang out? And it was like, I can't, and I didn't even reply to you because it was just, oh, I don't think I think I did saying no, actually. I did reply. I'm not that rude. But it was, because it's a choice, you know, you choose to come online, you choose to log in every day, you choose to say what's happening in your life or what's not happening in your life. So you can present yourself very well. You can actually present yourself as having achieved absolute self-actualization. And really, nothing's further from the truth. If you're a good role player, oh my gosh, some of the role players online, it's, you know, oh gosh, they've gotten a bit more ridiculous over the years, thank goodness. They're easy to spot. But I remember, again, back in the day, it used to be almost impossible to tell who was role-playing a Jedi and who was actually living the Jedi life. But, yeah, so I hear you on that. It was very brave of you, I think, to actually ask for help online. I wasn't able to do that.
Well,
until quite recently, then I did. I'm brave too.
To be fair, I didn't actually tell anybody what had happened or what was going to happen. And I didn't know that I was, and I'll go ahead and I'll explain a little bit about what happened after I wrote that. I felt like I had a foreboding feeling that I was not going to get the money that we needed, even though they told me I should have it at the end. And when I started realizing that this might be a thing, I went on and I said, I really need, if you guys need prayers or meditations, please, I could use them right now. Well, it took me a couple of days later for me to go back and explain to Vander on the phone, who is one of the people that I am very, very close to. I mean, he was my mentor, so. he was like, so what was that about? And I said, I went catatonic. After that, like about an hour after I posted that, I think it was about an hour, when it finally came, it's not going through. I'm not going to have that money. I don't know how I'm going to make it across the U.S. just for gas money. I mean, we were just, wow, I was blown away at how difficult this was going to be for us. And I stopped. Everything stopped. And I managed very barely to go and pull up the Soldier's Creed from the Army.
Oh, I know that one.
And I sat there and I stared at it. And I tried to read it, but I could not say anything. My eyes were just fixated for like 2 hours or so. I don't even remember how long it was. It was a while, though, before I finally came to. And my husband was like, do you want to leave tomorrow? We can stay here another night and then we can drive out. And I was like, oh no, we're leaving here. I don't want to be anywhere near the Coast Guard today.
Oh, Allie. I wish I could give you a hug. Oh, it's hard. And, you know, life happens. Life kicks you in the nutsack. And, yeah, I think it's great that you actually did go online and look for the support. Because, like you say, that's where people end up cracking. And you end up with Jedi Masters who completely crack. And they might be... You know what? They might be really good Jedi Masters, but because they didn't reach out for the Jedi community's help, you never hear from them again. And there was something pretty similar for me. I didn't feel like I could really talk to anybody, and I'm glad I did fall to the dark side. I think I belong there. But it would have been very different if I had felt I could talk to the community. And I don't mean to put it on the community, although it was very different back in 2010.
Yeah.
It's completely me. I'm a very proud person. But I feel like I'm circling around what I'm trying to say, which is that your online friendships can be real as long as you let them be real. There we go. You have to actually be willing to be real with the people online in order to have real relationships with people online. And on places like Facebook, especially, there's so much pressure to only show your best self. And it could be self-imposed pressure. You know, in my case, the only people who actually knew I was a mess after my dad died are the people who came knocking on my door and found me. I didn't even know what mess they found me in. I was just like, I've forgotten how to life. but yeah, it's like that. It's as real as you let it be. And so Maslow's hierarchy has no point if you're going to be fake. But it has a lot of point if you're actually being open with yourself and honest with yourself about where you actually are in your hierarchy of needs.
Now, your degree was in anthropology?
With an archaeological emphasis.
Archaeological emphasis, okay. So, I guess that it would have actually crossed sections a little bit into some of the studies of anthropology when you were looking into it, because you have to understand some of the cultures that you're going over. So, the question that I have now is, we were talking about how somebody goes from the basic needs to the next level, but sometimes they get locked in that security level and they can't go any further because maybe
safety,
they were abused or whatnot. Did you ever come across a situation where people were not honest about their safety and their security?
Oh, all the time. No one ever wants to admit that they're not safe. Because one of the things that people who are actually in chronically unsafe environments, whether we're talking abuse or we're talking, okay. So yes, all the time we do come across people who are stuck in the second tier, the safety and security, and they do lie about it. And you know, when we're talking about safety and security, it's very easy to go quickly to abusive situation. And it's not always that obvious. Sometimes you have someone who has a deep love of Harry Potter, and everyone in their family shames them for it.
Oh, no.
Not me. This isn't about me.
Oh, okay. I was going to say,
this is totally hypothetical. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, well, I prefer Harry Potter over Star Wars anyway, so...
Yeah, well, we've never figured out what's wrong with you. See, there we go. I'm making you unsafe. So, oh, actually, you know, the homosexual community is a really good example to look to. Being gay, not a big deal to a lot of people, but then to some people, it's a huge deal. And they can't tell their family. They can't tell their friends. And they have no clue what to do. And if they, but they love their family, they love their friends. And if they were to actually admit to themselves that they felt unsafe, then they would be suddenly faced with the extraordinary dilemma of what do you do when you admit this to yourself. A lot of the things we do, trying to get my words out together. Sorry, my thoughts are jumbling over each other so fast that it's hard to get them out. So we don't like to admit to ourselves when something needs changing, because the second we admit it to ourselves, we place upon us an impetus that then we must choose whether we change this or not, or maybe find some middle ground there. But basically it comes down to, I'm compromising myself. Am I okay to keep compromising myself? And the second that this question sort of enters your brain, you become less safe in your own head. So it can be homosexuality, it can be being a Dark Lord of the Sith, it can be anything else your family doesn't approve of. but this moment of unsafety, once it happens, it's dangerous. You can get stuck there for a very, very long time.
And yeah, I guess that would go into the next one, is sense of belongingness, because if you don't feel the safety in your own head of being able to just accept that you're this way or that way, or even, I guess if you're from the Christian perspective, to cope with the fact that homosexuality is supposed to be against the whole belief system. And that's got to be something that's really, really awkward for people in that position. You know, here I am, I'm a Christian, but I'm supposed to be an abomination to God. And how exactly do I cope with that? And there's been people that have written ways that they can deal with that. But at the same time, I think unless you can completely overcome the idea that you are homosexual, whether it's acceptance or acceptance that you're never going to be accepted the way that you are, or even just acceptance that if you want to be, see, and I think that's almost unhealthy too. It is unhealthy. Is like, it's one thing if you feel like, okay, I'm very fat and I need to get rid of my fat. But when it's something about you that you have sat there and you've thought to death about, and you still keep coming to the same conclusion, like homosexuality is fine, and you keep coming to that same conclusion, to not let that in when you're trying to get to the next stage of belongingness, it's just not healthy.
Well, and that's why you do find people who do go and look for their friends online. And you do, people look for their people. I believe that's true. But one of the problems that you have, just sort of reel it back a second to what you were talking about do people lie about whether or not they're safe? It's like, if you can't admit something to yourself, because the second you admit it, it becomes unsafe, then of course you can't admit it to anybody else. And of course you're going to present what you believe the safe truth is as truth, and it will be true, because it's still true in your own head. I'm trying to think of, oh gosh, I had something and it went away. It'll come back if it's important. But just that, presenting yourself, the way you present yourself online, now it's gone. Sorry.
It's okay, it happens.
It was very deep and profound, I guarantee it.
Isn't that deep. How it works when you meditate? Like, I noticed that I've kind of noticed it before, but when we did the actual Force Realists meditation recently, I didn't really pay attention to just how many thoughts fill up my head when I'm doing a meditation like the one that I did. And I realized, I came out of it, I was like, all those thoughts could be probably put into 10 hours worth of video if I could get them all out. I couldn't say them fast enough. It just...
Do you do stream of consciousness writing?
I used to do that. I used to actually be pretty good at that. I don't know why I haven't been able to do it as of recent. But I'm sure it'll come one day.
I keep a running list on my phone, actually, of everything that I want to write a lecture about or do a lecture about. So that when I get time, I go through my list and I'm like, oh, yeah, that's right. So I do have that, but oh my gosh, finding time. Or I shouldn't even say finding time. Making the Sith online thing a priority. There we go. I'm very bad at that.
You and me both. I feel like I kind of fail the community sometimes because I don't put enough emphasis on lectures and whatnot. I find that I'm constantly just telling people, trying to explain to people when they ask a question, and I'm just like, yeah, I probably should write something about that. It took me 5 years before I actually wrote a lecture on Jedi and drugs. 5 years! But I talked about it constantly whenever it came up.
What did you have to say? Drugs are bad. Don't do them.
Well, I tied it into being reckless, and I'll probably do a video in the future on it. And I outlined some things that I've seen in my own life from different types of narcotics. Well, not just narcotics. I mean, hallucinogens, narcotics, and whatnot. And even a time when there was a member who was on Force Academy that I'd gotten back from Iraq, and he called me the one night that I accidentally got drunk. That sounds so weird. You accidentally got drunk. No, seriously, I didn't. They say, and I've
been
told.
It was the one night that sounded weird to me. Like, well, what do you mean every other night for me?
Yeah, I don't drink a lot. And if I do, it's not a lot. It's like maybe a glass of wine. Well, I drank my normal amount this one night. And it was like one night out of the entire 3 months. I hadn't drank in a long time. And I drank the normal amount, but it had an over effect on me because I had just gotten out of an online relationship, which was with a guy that I had met one time in person. Well, anyway, it was like I couldn't understand my actions and the whole thing. So I ended up drinking the normal amount, and my emotions affected my alcohol levels.
Good Jedi, come to us.
So I ended up doing this, and this guy, he was a kid, he was a teenager, he was getting drunk that night too, and he realized it was a mistake, so he calls me and he's trying to figure out what to do. Now I'm so drunk at this point that I'm like enunciating my words. And I'm sitting there, I was like, good grief, I don't know how to, I can't help this poor kid who really needs my help. And so to me, I learned that night that when you're a Jedi, and especially when you're a Jedi Master, you really have to be aware of your levels and other drugs. Just drugs in general are not really good to get engaged in. I mean,
for Jedi.
Yes, for Jedi. I'm not saying anybody else, because obviously everybody else, you know, Jedi are supposed to be there to help people. That's always been my stance. Even though I'm sure some people will argue ad nauseum that it's a stupid stance to take.
No, it's fine. I'm not a big fan of anything that makes me lose control of myself either, so.
That too. Yeah, that's actually my biggest fear, is losing complete control of myself. And I found that out through back in 2013, I think. We did a shamanic journey with Gabe Calderon from Chicago Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned that my biggest fear was not having control over myself.
Is this the one that Miles went to?
Yes, it is actually the one that Miles went to.
Oh, I've heard all about this. I know everything you
Oh,
did.
You know everything. Oh, no. Oh, God. He probably said something like, yeah, Allie's dumb. She let this happen. And
no one has said that. No one has said that about you. We love you over here. We think you're great. We don't think you're stupid or dumb.
Well, that's good to know. I'm going to have to definitely do another gathering, and hopefully this time all of you can come out. I'm going to try to
have it in California.
Well, I don't think I can get that far out.
No, I know.
Plus, if I go that far out, I might not be able to drag Chaos out.
That's true.
Yeah, I want everybody, at least that's U.S.-based, to be able to come out that I love.
Everybody?
That I love.
Yeah, but you love some really weird people.
I'm not going to say anything online on the record for that one.
That's all right. They know who they are.
They do.
No, it's all right. I'm sure I can get along with some strange people for a weekend. I wanted to also just talk about, because you were talking about different cultures, anthropology, right, before we went off on a whole other tangent. And one of the things that I do want to just sort of say is that not all of the people I speak to actually like Maslow's hierarchy. And I have a friend over in the real-life supervillain community who hates it. He hates it so much, he redesigned it. And I wanted to tell you about the redesign because I thought it was actually really good. I seem to have baffled you. Where did I lose you? Was it the redesign or the real-life supervillains?
There's that one, the real-life supervillains. And in my head, I'm thinking of a Sith-esque type community that was kind of like the Tothian for us in the Jedi community.
Well, you didn't think you were the most ridiculous people out there, did you?
We do some really ridiculous people, but I'm trying to figure out, is that more ridiculous than, say, that other academy that we don't like to name because they're on the FBI watch list?
Oh, I don't think the real-life supervillains are on the FBI watch list. They haven't made that much infamy yet. But they do exist, and you also have real-life superheroes. And it is kind of a Jedi Sith thing for people who just don't like Star Wars.
Unless maybe you should check them out. Unless you happen to be a guy named Tothian. He's actually, I think he's on the real-life, I think he runs the real-life superheroes version.
That wouldn't surprise me. They're terrible. Oh my gosh, they need destroying.
It's kind of sad here that she's saying it like that, but even I'm kind of sitting here and I'm like, I kind of agree, actually.
Excellent.
Look, I'm sorry. When a guy claims to be the Archangel Michael, and I can't count how many times I've heard somebody say that they are the reincarnation of the Archangel Michael, and then they say, oh, I patrol the streets of, I think it's New York, and he tries to come in, you know.
Oh, it's not Phoenix Jim, is it?
No, his name is Tothian. Oh, okay. Like, he's actually...
Oh, his superhero name is Tothian.
His superhero name is Tothian. And he...
That's a terrible name.
It is. It really is a terrible name. He came in, and that's when I started going back at the Aiding Emergency Services program, because I was like, oh gosh, here we go again with another vigilante. It was like, the police don't really, you know, we try to help the police. And I'm like, dude, you're like talking about how you're fighting and stuff. No, that's not how this works.
Well, yeah. Oh, no, they just, you know, there was a really great question posed at the Force Academy a little while ago about why be a villain and why be a hero. And I don't remember which of your side was talking on it. But I know that Chaos posted something really great, which is about how it's actually harder to be a villain, because for a villain, you have to have vision and you build your empire and you're doing something. And basically all the hero has to do is come along and screw you over. So the light aspect, or the superheroes, are basically entirely reactive, whereas it's the villains who are actually building. And I just thought that was a really good point. And it's very true in the real-life superhero, supervillain community. The supervillains are building their lives, they're building empires. And all the superheroes are really doing is running around in the street with pepper spray, getting in the police's way. So, okay. Nice. You stay over there.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's actually where I'll have to do one day a show where I explain the difference between them doing what they're doing and how Jedi are actually about, because we actually have to sit there and think about our actions and how they play. It's not just about going in and rescuing the day.
I would not have guessed that. The standards, Ali, pull them up. No, I'm sure. I agree. You know, the Jedi are supposed to be much more reflective than, you know, and I can't speak very poorly. I'm going to say this because this is on the Force Academy. A lot of the Jedi at the Force Academy are absolutely wonderful. And I am teasing. I just have a very dry sense of humor. So I sound like I'm serious when I'm talking.
Okay, sorry about that. We have to come back because my son got in the way again, which means this is going to take quadruple the time to load. Because I have to go in and edit. Oh, well, that's okay. So we were talking about supervillains, and she mentioned that she had a dark sense of humor, and then my son came in.
I said a dry sense of humor.
Dry sense of humor, that's right. And so, yeah.
It might be dark, too. I don't know.
Well, you know, I mean, that's obviously very indicative of the whole Welsh side of things, because they do have a dry sense of humor. And, you know, I think it's fun. I love it. I love that kind of humor. It's great, especially because it can be so subtle. And people would never notice, and you're just over here laughing.
It's true. It's sometimes a little too subtle for the American audience, I fear. Not for you. You're lovely. You seem to laugh at all my jokes. It's like, oh, I'm gratified.
Now, if only I could have jokes. I don't have jokes. I suck at them.
Oh, Ali, you are a joke. I'm sorry, you keep leaving yourself wide open.
Yeah, Nathan says that all the time.
Okay. So, yes. Well, I can't talk. Here I am. My friends at the real life supervillain community. But anyway, so real life supervillains. And one of them in particular really hates Maslow's hierarchy. And he redesigned it into something which he calls the onion.
The onion.
So it's a sphere. And at the very center of the sphere is you, to begin with. And then the first level is your self-esteem. Because he says, self-esteem isn't something that you need to rely on other people for. If you don't have good enough self-esteem to feed yourself, then you're never, ever even going to meet the bottom level of Maslow's hierarchy. He says, if you don't have enough self-esteem to protect yourself, you're never going to meet the second tier of Maslow's hierarchy. So, and then he has like relationships at the very edge, like all good supervillains. that's the least important thing. No. I'm joking. But basically it was just that idea of, you know, and I don't know if this is true for the light siders, and you'll have to sort of let me know, because this idea that if you don't pick yourself up off the ground, sitting around waiting for someone else to come and do it is, well, you could be sitting there for years. You could be sitting there for forever. People will think you're dead and they won't care. You know, it's just, so if you don't have that self-esteem first, which on Maslow's hierarchy is the fourth tier, if you don't have that first, then nothing else will ever actually come into fruition for you. So I thought I would just throw that out there. So you have this onion where it's you, your self-esteem, your security and safety, and then security and safety and eating, he kind of put that into one tier where he was like, come on, you need to eat and you need to be safe.
Right.
So I would still divide it again back to eating, security and safety. And then on the very outside is whether or not you actually belong in society and whether or not you have friends. Because there's, you know, we have that sort of individuality on the dark side, which sometimes gets taken way too far in the wrong direction. And, you know, Irvine called me on that one many years ago. It was like, well, you know, you don't exist in a vacuum. You're allowed to have friends. You know, you are surrounded by people. You can't be wholly independent. No one can be wholly independent unless you're going to go live in the hills and wear a tinfoil hat or something. But that sort of, there is that sort of core to it, this idea that if you don't pick yourself up, why should anyone else care enough about you to pick you up?
That's true. And oftentimes, well, now that you put it in that way, it kind of draws me over to other people that can't necessarily help themselves anyway. Like, people that have specific disabilities which keep them from mentally being able to exist the way that, say, you and I do.
Yeah, and that's always been a conversation in the Jedi communities, and I want to say the Force communities as a whole, is can a disabled person be a Jedi? Can a disabled person be a Sith? Well, we have, Miles and I occasionally talk about whether or not a homeless person can be a Sith. A person who is actively living in this helpless state dependent on the kindness of other people.
Now, it's interesting that would be one of the cases. We did have a Jedi that did that for a lot while. He would be, I guess you could say, more of a vagabond.
Well, a Jedi can be a vagabond. Right. But kind of Sith. That's a good point.
And what he did, well, it was weird because what he did was he worked to improve his community anyway through that. So it does make you wonder, could, if you do live in that state, if you still work and maybe, I don't know, like you go and you start coordinating with somebody to get a plot of land so that you can, your passion, as Chaos would put it, because that's his belief, is that the Sith community helps you build up to get to your passions. If your passion is to get a plot of land and put a farm together for the rest of your homeless community, would that actually qualify as something that would work?
I think it's a very simplified perspective of Chaos's philosophy. I'll just say that straight away. The Chaos's philosophy is more about using passion to actually, in the language we're using, achieve self-actualization. Because here's the thing. Okay, Sith are architects of their own lives. And that's, I am an INTJ, which is an architect. So maybe I just think in architectural terms. But when you're the architect of your life and you're looking at your life and you're like, this can be anything I want, literally anything I want. I get to design my life. Where do you start? And you have to start somewhere, because otherwise, and a lot of people do fall into this trap, otherwise you just sit around and do nothing for the rest of your life because you couldn't pick a starting point. You couldn't decide where to start. So your starting point is your passion. What do you do when you don't have to do anything? Go from there. So, okay, so let's suppose that this person's passion is to be homeless and, I don't know, go find a spare piece of land. Is that what you were saying?
Sure, yeah.
Into a farm. You know what? I guess so. You know, David once said about lousy passions and
that's
your
a good
passion
point.
Is your passion. Yeah. I'm not going to say that's lousy in case there is somebody right now who's like, oh, maybe I should join the online Sith community, but my passion is farming. And now I'm not going to do it because Luciana spoke harshly about farming. No. Now, farming is great. We need farmers. For me, when I was thinking about it, it's always more on the side of dependence. So I don't think about the homeless person with a passion, because that's a totally different example to when I was living in San Francisco. I was approached by a guy. He thought I was cute, and he wanted to know if I wanted coffee. And he's homeless. He's obviously homeless. I dropped a quarter in his cup, and he follows me to the train station saying, do you want coffee? And I was like, I don't know how to say this. You're homeless. I just gave you a quarter. And he says, no, I just choose to live this way. I like to be outside the system. He says, I have a car and I have a savings account and I can take you out for coffee. And I was just sort of baffled by this idea that you would want to live on the streets, that would be preferable to you over everything else. And even still, you know, I'm still talking about it like it's his passion. So I guess the point that I'm really trying to get at is somebody who is 100% dependent for every single thing, like a lot of homeless people are. I probably shouldn't have chosen homelessness. This is probably a really flawed example. Okay. But and has no desire to change that. What do you do with that?
That's a good question.
And can that person be a Sith? And again, I guess, you know, you have sort of answered it. If it's their greatest passion, I guess so.
Now so I'm going to be wondering about this. I totally do. And it would be interesting to see if you had Chaos in on that one, too. Because at one point in time, he and I did, I think we did a show, or we were just chatting. I don't remember, but I distinctly remember he said, it's stupid But if somebody wanted, if someone came into the Sith community and their whole passion was to get into jail, then I guess we would be helping them figure out how to get into jail. And they would be, and that would be their Sith passion. And it would be a very Sith-like philosophy because it's passion. And I'm like, because I don't agree with it. I'm just kind of sitting there like, somebody who's, and it's strange to hear that when you think of things that are what normal society, I guess we can call it normal, for the lack of any other better words to explain what I'm saying, normal society sees as a negative, jail time, homelessness, or whatnot, where you are having to be dependent on somebody. And I mean, even in prison, you would be dependent on somebody because you wouldn't have to worry about anything except for maybe getting beat up. And then I guess part of your passion would be surviving prison.
Can survival be a passion? I feel like we're confusing the pyramid's gone to hell. The top is now the bottom.
Or in the center and then out.
I purposefully destroyed my life so that I could fulfill my passion of surviving. I don't know. But you're right. That's part of the beauty of the dark side of the Sith is we do have, there's room for unconventional passions. There's room for unconventional life choices. There's room for, oh my goodness, this is such a great thing. I was reading about it the other day. The question of how can two right people, or how can two good people disagree on something? And it's one of those things. When I see, I'm going to say light aspect people in general, and I don't just mean the Force Academy, I mean in other communities too, they'll talk about how they do X because it's the good thing to do, and how good is this sort of nebulous, unconfirmed, undefined state of being, nobility, virtuous, and everyone somehow inherently knows what it is without having to explain it. But then you have, I hate to bring this in, the current election, where you have two sides of the country utterly convinced that they are both good, and they are both voting for the good candidate and the right person. And one of the things that the Sith paradigm really does allow is for everyone to be good. Everyone's right.
Even Hitler? You're like, yeah, sure.
I've already said Hitler did great things. I don't have to agree with every single one of Hitler's philosophies, but he has done more in his life than you have.
Damn. That's true. He did. Still don't agree with him. But he did do more than I have.
Just saying.
Someone's going to see this and think, oh, these people are nuts. They're actually reminiscing about how Hitler was better than them.
It doesn't help that we're both white.
Oh, God. No, it doesn't. I guess it doesn't. Oh, well, whatever.
There you go. That's the balls to the wind attitude I like to hear. Whatever.
How did we used to do it, like, back in the day? Whatever. You're like, now you really are showing your age. You're so much older than me.
I don't know whose day that is, yeah. I was never that geeky.
Oh, man. So I guess, yeah, it seems like maybe Maslow's hierarchy is not completely, but I think that it's good. I mean, even when you look at it from the onion, at least you have a starting point of something that you can do, and you can work your way through it to get where you need to go. Maybe these are all tiers that need to be met, but maybe the order is not necessary. Like, I don't know. You could probably switch the physiological needs with belonging and the safety needs with the belongingness and love needs, because that would increase your security. Maybe. I mean,
I don't think anything really takes much precedence over physiological needs. You can have all the friends in the world, and if you don't have any food, you're probably going to die. But the safety and the friendship one is pretty interesting. Because sort of go back to the previous example we were using with homosexuality. A lot of people who identify as a member of the LGBTQ plus, is it LGBTQA plus? There we go. community will go online and find friends who they can speak to openly about being on the spectrum. No, is it a spectrum? That's autism.
Yeah, I'm not really sure.
I'm not sure. Where they fit
their
on the
identity.
Rainbow.
We'll say that. Yeah, there you go.
Where they fit on the rainbow. They'll go and they'll talk to people online about it. And through making friends online, they'll end up having the courage to take themselves to a place of safety. I know there was one person on Reddit a long time ago who was living in one of the more war-torn countries in the world. And she actually made friends on Reddit and was able to escape a family that wanted her dead and move to America and do the immigration thing very legally and find here in this country much more safety and security than she personally had in her own family back home. So it's very fluid. It's not set in stone. And I think what it does do very well is it does sort of provide, let's say, four categories, and then you've got self-actualization as kind of a separate thing, where you can say, these are four categories of my life. Relationships, say my nutrition, my safety and my security, and my feeling of self-worth. And whatever order you want to put them in, like I kind of got them in a square right now, whatever order you put them in, you can sort of look at each of them and just say, well, where do I measure up on this? Where do I measure up on that? And which one of these areas needs working on for me to realize my full potential?
So I guess we've really just torn into Maslow's hierarchy, didn't we?
Dismantle it.
We did dismantle it. We've turned it into an onion, and now we've turned it into a square.
Well, it's a house.
A house?
It's got the four windows. And
oh,
the
yes.
Roof.
And then the, yes. Man, I didn't expect us to do that. You know what?
Maslow's house.
I think it's actually really fun to do that. You know, just come up with different things that work, because sometimes it won't work for other people. But everything we talk about is still all generic. It's still there. We might have a different order that we have to achieve it, or feel like we have to achieve it, or a different notice that we need more work. And like, if you pour into a cup. And you're, or you have a pitcher and you need to pour, and you're like, oh, okay, well, I need to make this a little bit more even here in this area. Yeah, it's interesting. And, you know, the Reddit thing that you had, it's not the only example. I actually have another one. Back when Jedi Sanctuary was a order, there was a guy who came to a Jedi named Richard Strange in the UK. And he was saying that he was in a prison in Syria, I believe. I don't remember exactly which one. But he was trying to get his date. Now, if it was Syria, I'm pretty sure it was Syria. So I'm just going to operate on it was Syria. They had had, and I did a lot of research on this at the time, they had some really horrific practices, and they were keeping people over longer than what they needed to. People were not getting to their dates to go to see the judge, and there were just lots and lots of, it was terrible. We don't even know how this guy managed to get a phone to communicate with us, but he did, and he reached out to find somebody in the Jedi community that would help him. And I remember I came up with a pseudonym. I did this, and I called up his lawyer in the area. Like, this was while I was in Japan, and I got my Skype call to go to that country. Called the guy, and it was funny because I actually, the last name I made up was very similar to the last name of the guy, and I didn't know that. So he was like, oh, your name is just like mine, because he didn't understand the difference in dialects. And I'm like, wish I had actually looked into what this guy's name was. But we all worked together. We got him, he was a immigrant, like on a visa over there in Syria. And I'm not even going to get into how he got in there, but he was trying to do something to help somebody else. And he got ended up in jail because it was still technically illegal. And he took the fall for everybody else that participated.
Dang.
But he was actually from another country out in the Pacific. And so we all worked together. We kept in contact with him through the internet. It's like sending him messages. We got in contact with a little Jedi community that was in his country. And then we got them in contact with his wife. And from there, those people worked with their country to send a letter forward saying, hey, we want him back. And he got back to his country. It worked out really well. And this was all stuff that we did over the internet. And we, you know, this belongingness to him was in the Jedi community, and that's where he found his help.
That's really cool. That should be like on your front page all the time. We actually help real people, by the way. That's what I'm saying when I say that you're so terrible at your own marketing sometimes.
We are.
So this is such a great story. Why doesn't everyone know this story? But no, that's really touching. That's really awesome. Well done.
I was a minor role in there, but Richard Strange, he was a huge role in that. And he came to me, and the reason he had come to me was because he thought that it might have been a phishing scam. But he said, this doesn't fit that description. Because back then, when it was going on, that was the time when you'd have the Nigerian prince sending you a message and stuff like that. Yeah. So we were kind of confused, and he was like, I need somebody to research this and figure this out. And I was like, okay, I'll do it. I took it on, and you know, from there, when I confirmed that the story was true, we kept in communication with him, but Richard did a lot of the legwork. He was the one that found the Jedi group in that country, that obscure country. Now, because the person's on my friends list, I'm not going to say what country it is, because it is so obscure, it's not hard to find him. But the fact that he was able to find a Jedi group there floored me. I was just like, they don't even really speak the same language. I mean, they have people that are English speakers, but they don't really speak the same language. And you managed to find their website back in 2010. It was a little bit more difficult to figure out how to do that stuff. So, I mean, I admit, I was thoroughly impressed by his work.
Now, that's impressive. I don't have anything to top that. That's cool. Well done.
Yeah, these are things that, and you know, that's one thing that I guess that needs to be put out here with this, is that, you know, when you have the belongingness and the esteem needs, like we were going back to, yes, the Jedi community or the online community is helpful in that. It's also very important to recognize that if you can't do, like, if your self-actualization is to help people, say like the Jedi do, and you can't do that in your where you are, like I can't. I have the internet, and that's all I have that I can help anybody with right now until I can get past the financial problem that I've got and plateau and go into volunteer work. And that sounds so weird. You can't do volunteer work without money? No, you can't. You need to have money to get the gas to go to your volunteer job.
Oh no, volunteering is absolutely a luxury. That's why all the rich people do it.
Exactly. So, but you know, there are things that you can do online, and connecting with these people, it will help actually help you get there. So you shouldn't, I feel like so many people get caught up in the whole, well, I can't do anything. And trust me, I have been there. I have to remind myself about that story that I just told you to remember that I don't have to be out in the world doing things, helping people if I can't do it.
Oxygen mask on you first.
Yeah.
Then worry about everybody else. Yeah, well, that's a good example, because that's, again, you know, talking about the second tier, if we follow the regular pyramid, with the security and safety, you know, or yeah, it would be security and safety for you because you are eating.
Yes.
You are breathing. So yeah, that's a good story. Thank you for telling me that story. Put it on your webpage somewhere.
Maybe I should write, maybe I should get together with Richard and write the tale so that we can post it somewhere and get that information out. Because, yeah.
No, it's good. It's good to have examples of how having the online community actually can affect real life. I much prefer how it is right now, where there seems to be a bit more emphasis on connecting in real time and connecting with the real people. Because when you build up the online community, you know, it can become basically a shell full of people who are just role-playing, or it can become a real living, breathing entity. And what you're describing is what you can do when it's a living, breathing entity versus what it is when it's just a bunch of people logging in to argue over whether the guitar is blue or red. To go back to an obscure reference that nobody will catch because it was cut.
That's true. But I did mention you have a blue guitar, so maybe...
Well, I think that about wraps that up.
I think it does. So I really enjoyed this conversation with you, and I hope that other people got something from it, and we hope that you awaken the night within.